All right. Carrying on with 1 Peter, a little bit of short review, kind of remind you of where we are, and then we'll pick back up. In chapter 2, verses 11 and 12, Peter tells these persecuted Gentile Christians in Asia Minor to live such good lives among the unbelievers, to live exemplary lives among the unbelievers, so that though they falsely accuse them of doing evil, they may be ultimately led to Christ by observing their good works, and thus may be part of the chorus glorifying God when Christ returns to finalize history. This idea is saying, listen, you need to live this kind of life that you might have this influence on people, even who are accusing you of doing evil. And we talked about that last week, and it's a very important thing. Now, this good living that he calls them, and of course calls us, Peter is writing to these Gentile Christians in Asia Minor. The Spirit is in the first instance speaking through Peter to these Christians. And then when we hear correctly what Peter is saying to these Christians, then we're in a position to hear what is the Spirit of God saying to us through what he said to those Christians. So Peter's writing to them. He tells them that this good living that he's urging them, and therefore urging us, this the way we're to be to live exemplary lives, it includes submission to authorities. And the first such authority to which they are to submit, the governing authority, is addressed in chapter 2, verses 13 to 17. And that's what we were looking at when we ended last. Okay, chapter 2, verses 13 to 17. Peter says, submit to every human creature on account of the Lord, whether to a king as being supreme or to governors as those sent by him, for punishment of those who do evil and praise of those who do good. For this is the will of God. By doing good, you are to silence the ignorance of foolish men. Do so as free people, yet not as those viewing freedom as a cloak for evil, but as God's slaves. Honor all men, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. Now, referring to Paul's comments in Romans chapter 13, verses 1 through 5, I pointed out last week that Christians must submit to governmental authorities because those authorities, the position of authority within the society, has been established by God. And he did that. He established authority within society to be a blessing through preventing anarchy and social chaos. And as I said last week, if you've ever seen a place where there's been a total breakdown, it's not a happy sight where there's simply anarchy in a society. It's a dangerous place. It is a bad place where people are killed and might makes right. And so this is God is seeking to bless humanity through creating the concept or the idea, the institution of authority within societies. I also noted that the Christian submission to governmental authorities doesn't depend on the goodness of the person occupying the office. It depends only on the fact that the person's occupying the position of authority that God has established within the society. As I said, when Paul wrote Romans and when Peter wrote 1 Peter, the ruler of Rome, the emperor, was Nero. And Nero was a psychopath. And his craziness, it came to full flower a bit later, but still, you could tell this guy is, you know, he's a screwball. I mean, just bent on evil. And so he says, look, but he is in that position. He occupies that position. I also noted that God sometimes brings or allows evil people to come to power for his own purposes, which are not always discernible to us. You see, so this is kind of a subset then of the whole question of suffering. You know, where we wind up saying, why is this happening? Why? And the answer sometimes simply is you don't know. And you're not going to be able to figure it out. And what you have to do is to trust that the God who spoke everything into existence and who loves you to death, that he's working for your blessing and he's working all things for good. Now, sometimes you just have to hold on to that like a mad dog because, you know, I've used the illustration before. If you remember the old Star Trek, in fact, the back to the TV series, the pilot episode, you've got this guy, Christopher Pike. He's the commander of the Starship Enterprise. And he goes to this is before James T. Kirk, but he goes and he's on this island, Talos, this planet, Talos. And he's there and these little scrawny guys with the big heads, they imprison this guy. prison, but he finally figures out that what they're doing is they're giving him, they're able to control his mind and project into his mind all of these illusions. So like he shoots his phaser at the wall and it looks like it didn't do anything, so he doesn't try to go through it, but really it blew the wall out. So he catches on to that, snatches one of these little guys when they're sliding him food, and he starts strangling this guy, this little scrawny dude, and he's strangling him, and the guy, and then the thing gives him this impression that he's strangling this fierce monster. And see, he was then put in a position where he had to trust what he knew more than what he was seeing. And I think that's how we are in living. This world at times throws us so much, and it's like the monster showing us that we just have to hold like a mad dog to the truth. We know that God is committed to us. You see, I see what's beyond. Yes, I see. So the horror of the scene, we sometimes have to transcend that and just trust. Listen, I know the cross. God is committed to me. And so that's an important thing. And so I say that, see, because this idea of God bringing evil people into positions is kind of a subset of that larger question. But God holds those evil rulers accountable for their wickedness, sometimes within history, ultimately at the judgment. So he brings them. He does it. You see it with the Assyrians. You see it with the Babylonians. All right. Now, Peter says that their obedience to governmental authority, he says it's to be done on account of the Lord. See, submit to every human creature on account of the Lord. Okay, submission is to be on account of the Lord, meaning they're to obey those authorities ultimately because of their reverence for and their submission to Jesus. Christians cannot obey governmental authorities when to do so would be to disobey God. Right? We cannot do that because that would then be what? That would be idolatry. We would then be saying the government is the ultimate authority in our life. God calls me to this. Government calls me to that. But I'm going to go with government. Well, then you're putting that in the position above God. And you cannot do that. You see, as Peter and the other apostles put it to the Sanhedrin in Acts chapter 5, verse 29, we must obey God rather than men. That's always true. We have to obey God rather than men. And otherwise, see, as I say, it's a form of idolatry if we don't do that. And you can see a number of examples in Scripture of this kind of civil disobedience. When Pharaoh ordered the Hebrew midwives to kill the newborn boys, they disobeyed. He says, kill these Jewish children. I'm the ruling authority of the society, and I tell you to, no, I'm not going to do that. You see, so that's in Exodus chapter 1. When Nebuchadnezzar, he ordered all his subjects to fall down and worship his golden image. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said, no dice. You know, can't do that. When King Darius decreed for 30 days, nobody should pray to any god or man except to him. Okay, well, what happens then? Well, Daniel says, no, can't do that. When the Sanhedrin bans preaching in the name of Jesus in Acts chapter 4, the apostles refuse to obey that. So you see illustrations of this principle that God is God. And when governmental authority calls us to do what is immoral, contrary to the will of God, it is then our duty as Christians to disobey. Okay, we cannot follow in that. And I don't know what all implications that may have for the future. Now, it's God's will that in doing good and being good and virtuous citizens, okay, so that we are people who are good and virtuous citizens. It's His will that in being that they will silence the ignorant talk of foolish men who falsely accuse them of being a threat to the social welfare. That's probably what he's talking about, because that's how Christians often were charged with that. In the early days. Why? It was because they were seen as odd, different, sojourners, aliens. Here we have this nice uniform society, and here you people are out with this oddball religion, and you're not fitting in. And so all kinds of things were said about Christians. They said they ate kids. They did all this kind of stuff. See, they were out of step with the culture, and so they were seen as a threat to the cohesion of the society. He says, you live such good and virtuous lives that you put the lie to that kind of stuff, that you're not a threat to the social welfare, that you are, in fact, a blessing to the social welfare. Okay, so this is what I think he's talking about there. They're to submit to the authorities, he says, as free people. I'm not sure here, but what I think he's talking about there, submit as free people, as people who ultimately are not answerable to the state. You see, we are free. Yes, there's a sense we're under the state's authority, but ultimately our allegiance is to God. He says, submit to the state, to the governing authorities as free people, but as people who don't they don't view that freedom as a cover for rebellion, but who realize that the one who is their master, the one to whom they're ultimately responsible, he calls them to submit to that authority. So submit as free people, as people who really, you know, when Jesus says, you have no power over me that wasn't given to you. We are, our allegiance is ultimately to God, and he's the one we serve. But we don't then say, because I'm free in that sense, I'm free to rebel. He says, no, the one we serve as God is the one who calls us to submit to that governing authority. And so I think that's what he's talking about. And then the four commands in verse 17, they set forth obligations to the people and ruler in the worldly sphere. You see, honor all men, honor the king. And to the people and ruler in the heavenly sphere, love the brotherhood, fear God. And he calls them here, he tells them, gives these commands, these obligations to the people and ruler in the earthly sphere, to the people and ruler in the heavenly sphere, obligations that I think they were tempted to ignore because of their persecution. He doesn't say this, but I'm just smelling that. When he gives them these things, I can see why people who are being persecuted would have to be reminded of these obligations. He says that Christians are to treat all human beings as special or important, honor all men. See, to treat them with dignity and respect, and I suspect this was to counteract the temptation spawned by local persecution to treat people outside the church with contempt. You see, if the church is getting pressured, the church is being persecuted, you know, ostracized, dragged into court and all this kind of stuff, it is very easy to treat people outside the church with contempt rather than honor, rather than with dignity. And I think he's warning them, say, listen, you need to maintain this idea of you honor all men. He reminds them that they're to love the brotherhood. You say, well, how is that related to this idea? I think, you know, it's tempting to distance yourself from the brotherhood when it is your affiliation with the brotherhood that is drawing the ire of the society. It is easy to say, it is my attachment, my identification with this strange group of people. That as people are now looking down on, and that's where the heat is, I start to kind of want to walk away from that. And so he tells them, he says, listen, you are to love the brotherhood. He says they are to fear God, which is a reminder to them not to yield to pressure to deny or to be unfaithful to him. We always have to remember that. Fear God. You see, in the sense that we talked about before, that you, it's not that you sit here and shudder and don't have intimacy with God. It is that you understand who God is and you fear the consequences of rebelling against him, just like you would with a parent. You see, I mean, you say, well, we fear. Well, I don't fear the parent when I'm doing right, but I do fear the parent if I'm going to sit here and spit on the parent. Well, I hope you would fear the parent. I hope you'd think, well, if I did that, the parent's going to wail on me. Can I say that in our society? Can I? Huh? Yeah. Can I? Or yeah. You see, or he's going to do something, or he'll put me in a timeout or whatever. Okay. He'll do something. She'll do something. You see, but it is this respect of understanding who the authority is and fearing God in that sense. And it's a reminder of them not to yield to that pressure to deny or be unfaithful to him, including being unfaithful to him and refusing to submit to government governing authorities. He's telling them you need to submit. We need to submit to the governing authorities. And lastly, he tells them that they are to honor the emperor. They have to honor the emperor, which just reinforces the point of verses 13 and 14. And you can see that the more alienated one feels from the society by virtue of this local persecution, the less you feel connected, you feel you're not being protected by the governing authorities, the more likely it would be that you would want to honor the political ruler. You see, you wouldn't want to do that. There's pressure on you. So he doesn't spell all that out, but I'm just guessing when he adds these things, honor all men, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. It has something to do with the specific context that they're getting pressured, that he needs to reinforce these obligations in their lives. All right. He says in chapter 2, verses 18 to 25, slaves, submit in all fear of God. I added of God, and I'll tell you why in a second. Submit in all fear of God to your masters. Not only to the good and gentle ones, but also to the harsh ones. For this is commendable, if someone bears the pains of suffering unjustly because of an awareness of God. But what credit is there if, when sinning and being beaten, you endure? But if when doing good and suffering you endure, this is commendable before God. For to this you were called, because Christ also suffered on your behalf, leaving you an example in order that you should follow in his steps. He did not commit a sin, nor was deceit found in his mouth. When being insulted, he did not return insults. When suffering, he did not threaten, but kept entrusting himself to the one who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, in order that having died to the sins, we might live for righteousness. By his wound, you were healed. For you were going astray like sheep, but you have now turned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. Now, I want to repeat for you background. Whenever I talk about, slaves and masters in the Bible, it is important to give some background of slavery in Greco-Roman society in the first century. And I did this when we taught Ephesians. I taught Ephesians when we got to that section. I did this. So if you remember what I'm saying, you just go to sleep for a couple minutes. Okay, I can usually put you there, but I'm going to repeat what I said there because I always want to do that in the context. Because this idea of slavery, I think it bothers us. You know, say, how do you make sense of that? And I hope I can help you out with that a little bit. Now, slavery was a basic social institution in the ancient world. Okay, you have to understand that. This fellow S. Scott Barchi, he's a world-class scholar on this. This is his field. This is not the only thing he does, but just to give you an example, he was dubbed to write the article on Greco-Roman slavery in the Anchor Bible Dictionary and also in the Dictionary of the Later New Testament and its developments. This is his field. I'm going to quote him quite a bit in a minute when we talk about the distinctions between Greco-Roman slavery and first century or in slavery in American society. But the Bible, it doesn't endorse or assume the goodness of slavery. Okay, it doesn't endorse it. It doesn't assume its goodness. It simply tolerates it. It takes slavery as a fact and then regulates people's involvement in it. Unlike marriage and parent-child relationships, Scripture nowhere suggests that slavery was ordained or instituted by God. Slavery was a product of sinful humanity. And you can see this in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 21. You can at least get a hint of this. 1 Corinthians 7:21, where Paul says, "Were you a slave when you were called? Don't let it trouble you, although if you can gain your freedom, do so." See, he would never give that kind of advice to spouses or to parents and children, saying, "Listen, whenever you can get out of this thing, get out of it." See, he wouldn't do that. Those things are instituted of God. Slavery was not. He wouldn't give that kind of advice. And in this regard, it's probably not coincidental that from all indications, neither Jesus nor the apostles owned slaves. Okay, I think that's something that's significant. Now, the seeds of slavery's dissolution, they were sown in various texts. For instance, in Philemon, he sits here and he says, "Look, you're to receive Onesimus back no longer as a slave, but better than a slave, as a dear brother." In Ephesians 6:9, he says, "Look, masters, do not threaten them. Do not threaten your slaves." Colossians 4:1, "Masters, provide your slaves what is right and fair." 1 Timothy 6:1-2, "Masters are what? They're brothers." Okay, so you see the seeds of slavery's dissolution sown here. And as many people have said, when these seeds of equality, when these seeds come to full flower, the very institution of slavery would no longer be slavery. When I have all of these things of equality and just fair treatment, all these things, when they come to flower, well, that institution is gone. And the fact that it took so long to happen, I think, is because of the dullness of Christians to the implication of the gospel. You see, now I will say, by the way, despite what you may hear, that the abolition of slavery in the Western world was spearheaded by Christians. Okay, that is who did it. They saw that this was something that was not right, and they were the spearheads of it. Now, the fact that God did not forbid Christians in the first century from owning slaves, but rather tolerated a regulated form of first century slavery doesn't mean that this was his ideal for mankind. Okay, it doesn't mean that was his ideal for mankind. His ideal is brotherhood and equality. You say, well, then why is he tolerating it? Well, I have to speculate on why he's tolerating it. Okay, but perhaps it's possible that the world had gotten so twisted that he was willing to tolerate less than his ideal as a concession to the hardness of men's hearts, something analogous to what he did with divorce. As you see in Matthew, through Moses in permitting divorce, and you see that in Matthew 19, verses 3 through 9. Or maybe he tolerated it because mandating the release of slaves in that particular social context would have caused anarchy and consequent suffering as the gospel spread across the Roman world. In other words, maybe it certainly seems rational to me to believe that the thorn of slavery needed to be removed slowly. See, perhaps society needed to be altered under Christianity's influence to be able to handle such a change without overwhelming adverse side effects. That's rational to me. I can understand that. If you simply say, just blast it, and you say, what would be the consequence? It would be tremendous suffering in the world. Okay, well, and then maybe we're too slow on the uptake on when and how we actually got about doing that. Now, he could have tolerated it. Let me read to you a quote from a guy, internationally known, the New Testament scholar, James Dunn. This is from his book, The Theology of Paul the Apostle. He says, slavery was an established fact of life in the ancient world. As many as one-third of the inhabitants of most large urban centers were slaves. The economies of the ancient world could not have functioned without slavery. Consequently, a responsible challenge to the practice of slavery would have required a complete reworking of the economic system and a complete rethinking of social structures, which was scarcely thinkable at the time, except in idealistic or anarchic terms. Now, in the context, so you have this regulated form of first century slavery, and in that context, if you had somebody, that God's tolerating, if release was desired there, then release needed to be worked out on the principles of brotherhood. But as long as the relationship stayed, then a Christian slave could not take advantage of having a Christian master, and the Christian master could not mistreat the slave. Okay, so this is a regulated form of first century slavery. Now, the point I really want to get, because this is where I think it bothers us when we read about slavery and what's going on with this in the New Testament, that God tolerated a regulated form of first century slavery doesn't mean he would tolerate that same form of slavery under different social conditions. He tolerated that form of slavery, a regulated form of first century slavery in that social context, and I've given you possible rationales for why he would do it. That doesn't mean that he would tolerate that same form of regulated slavery placed in a different social context. Nor does it mean that he would tolerate a form of slavery different from that form of slavery, which is what we had in America. The slavery that we had in America was very different from the institution of slavery in the first century Greco-Roman world. Okay, not saying that the slavery in the Greco-Roman world, there was nothing wrong with it. But it was a different institution. And what I'm saying is you cannot say, okay, he tolerated that there. He would tolerate that same form of slavery in a different social context. Or I can jump from that to saying he would tolerate different forms of slavery. We had people in the 18th century, 19th century, Bible people arguing for slavery based on the Bible. Okay? And this is why people think the Bible can be dangerous. It can be. You see, it's like in the Wizard of Oz, these have to be handled very delicately. You see, it's just, people don't like that. They say, I can just read it. Look, it takes some, it takes some sophistication to think through some things. Because you can see how people would do that. They were wrong to do it. And as I said, it was Christians who spearheaded the abolition of slavery in England. And over here, too. Let me read to you, this is a lengthy 5 full slides. So full, I didn't even put the guy's name on it. But this is S. Scott Barchi. And I want to read you these slides. This is from the Anchor Bible Dictionary, where he talks about the differences between slavery in the Greco-Roman world in the first century and American slavery. And if you've never heard these things, those of you who've been around me, you've heard them. But I think it's important to see that, because this is what troubles us sometimes. Now, these are not this runs over about 4 or 5 pages, and they're just selected paragraphs through those 4 or 5 pages. The paragraphs aren't continuous, but they're in order. Okay. He says central features that distinguish first century slavery from that later practiced in the New World are the following. Racial factors played no role. Education was greatly encouraged. Some slaves were better educated than their owners. And education enhanced the slave's value. Many slaves carried out sensitive and highly responsible social functions. Slaves could own property, including other slaves. Their religious and cultural traditions were the same as those of the freeborn. No laws prohibited public assembly of slaves, and perhaps above all, the majority of urban and domestic slaves could legitimately anticipate being emancipated by the age of 30. It must also be stressed that despite the neat legal separation between owners and slaves, in none of the relevant cultures did persons in slavery constitute a social or economic class. Slaves' individual honor, social status, and economic opportunities were entirely dependent on the status of their respective owners, and they developed no recognizable consciousness of being a group or of suffering a common plight. For this reason, any such call as slaves of the world unite would have fallen on completely deaf ears. They didn't see themselves that way. They didn't identify on the basis of slavery. Because if I'm here and this guy's a sea captain, and this guy over here is lowborn, see, I attached to that. It wasn't, my defining thing wasn't that I was not a free person. It was my identity with the status of the person who owned me. And he says, for this reason, any such call as slaves of the world would have fallen on deaf ears. The great slave rebellions, all of which were led primarily by prisoners of war between 140 and 70 B.C., never sought to abrogate slavery. Rather, these rebels sought either escape or to turn the tables by enslaving their owners. Furthermore, by no means were those in slavery regularly to be found at the bottom of the social economic pyramid. Rather, in that place were those free and impoverished persons who had to look for work each day without any certainty of finding it, day laborers, some of whom eventually sold themselves into slavery to gain some job security. Large numbers of people sold themselves into slavery for various reasons, for example, to pay debts, to climb socially. Roman citizenship was conventionally bestowed on a slave released by a Roman owner, to obtain special jobs, and above all, to enter a life that was more secure and less strenuous than existence as a poor freeborn person. Slaves were used for an enormous variety of functions in enormously different circumstances, some of which, when compared to New World slavery, seem astonishingly responsible. Doctors, teachers, writers, accountants, agents, bailiffs, overseers, secretaries, and sea captains, all slaves. You see, it wasn't just you're a slave, so this is what you do. You do menial labor. It wasn't that way at all. He says, since slaves represented a substantial investment by their owners, they could at least expect to receive enough food to keep them alive and working. Manumission could mean the end of that security. Epictetus, a first century philosopher, himself an ex-slave, took pleasure in pointing out that the slave who thinks only of gaining his freedom may be reduced when he's manumitted to slavery much more severe than before. For many, self-sale into slavery with anticipation of manumission was regarded as the most direct means to be integrated into Greek and Roman society. For many, this was the quickest way to climb socially and financially. As such, in stark contrast to New World slavery, Greco-Roman slavery functioned as a process rather than a permanent condition, as a temporary phase of life by means of which an outsider obtained a place within a society that had no natural obligations of kinship or guest friendship towards him. Okay? Now, I'm not saying, as I say, I don't want to sit here and say, well, you know, it was the greatest thing since sliced bread. Okay? There's something wrong with it. But I want you to understand that it was a different institution that was regulated and then tolerated. And I think the seeds are there that when that message is fully grown, that institution will be dead. Okay? That's how I understand it. Because God is good and He is working to bless people. And that's what I think was going on. Let me read you one other short one from Andrew Lincoln. He's another New Testament scholar. This is from his commentary on Ephesians. He says, many slaves in the Greco-Roman world enjoyed more favorable living conditions than many free laborers. Contrary to the supposition that everyone was trying to avoid slavery at all costs, it's clear that some people actually sold themselves into slavery in order to climb socially, to obtain particular employment open only to slaves, and to enjoy a better standard of living than they had experienced as free persons. Being a slave had the benefit of providing a certain personal and social security. Okay, that's all background. I say all that just when we talk about it because I know these things gnaw at us. We say, what is this? Slavery? Is God mean? Is God sinful? Is God evil? How can all right? So I'm trying to give you a way of thinking about this that says, no, you have to see it in a different way and see how God is working. And we just always have to be careful about, you know, there are times when things happen that people get angry with God. And I understand that. But we have to be careful about, sitting in judgment of God. OK, our impulse needs to be, I know he's right. Now, let me try to think through how. You see, all right. So here, back to chapter 2, verses 18 to 25. He commands the slaves to submit out of fear of God to their earthly masters, even those who mistreat them. Okay? Now, the motivating fear here seems clearly to be a fear of God in the sense that I previously talked about. Seems to be a fear of God rather than a fear of the master. Now, I think that because the fear of God was just commanded in the preceding verse. Elsewhere in the letter, you see that fear is directed toward God and not toward people. He's the one you're to fear. You're not to fear people. And the following verse, it specifies that the motivation here is an awareness or a consciousness of God. He says in 19, unjustly because of an awareness of God. So with many people, I believe that when he says here, submit in all fear, he means in all fear of God. Because you fear God, you know who he is. He calls you to submission. You submit out of that fear to your masters. And that's why I put that in brackets. And I don't know if some translations wind up doing that too. Now, it's commendable before God if one is willing to endure unjust treatment at the hands of human authorities, such as slave masters. It is commendable before God if in the face of unjust treatment that one refrains from rebelling against them. Now, you can see how that would be, right? I mean, if you're getting treated unfairly, unjustly, that's like when you're ready to go crazy, right? You know, the word go off comes to mind. You know, you're just really ready to. And he says, listen, that you are to bear up under this unjust suffering. You are to do this, to refrain from rebelling against them because you're mindful of God and he has called you to honor their authority, even when they're treating you unjustly. You are called to honor their authority. See, enduring justified punishment for wrongdoing. If you're getting your just desserts, you're caught stealing, you're caught doing something. Well, enduring punishment for that, that's not commendable because you're only getting what you deserved. You see, in that case, there's no injustice to swallow out of allegiance to God. You see, if I'm getting treated unfairly, I don't deserve this. He says, swallow that in honor of me. You see, this is why when I talk, when we think about Christian living, Christian life, and I think about, this cellophane tinsel junk that is portrayed as the depth of Christian living. This is the kind of stuff. And that's why people keep it up here. No, it's just really living life. Living life way down, and you see it right here. I mean, a perfect example of that. They were called to endure injustice at the hands of human authorities. See, without being sullen or rebellious. I can see that. You'd be going, well, I'm not doing anything this clown asked me to do. I'm going to fight him every step of the way. He'll wish he never messed with me. You see? Called to endure without being sullen or rebellious. Why? Because Christ suffered this way and left you an example. Verse 21, for to this you were called, because Christ also suffered on your behalf, leaving you an example in order that you should follow in his steps. He did not commit a sin, nor was deceit found in his mouth. When being insulted, how did he act? When being insulted, he did not return insults. When suffering, how did he act? He did not threaten. And he is it called you to follow in his steps. You see, he was sinless, perfect, drawing on Isaiah 53, verse 9. And yet he was horrifically abused by humans, right? There was absolutely, he was sinless. And how was he treated? So we know that what is happening to him is unjust. So he's being abused by human authorities, and rather than lashing out at his tormentors, who are unfairly, unjustly, absolutely treating him that way, instead of lashing out to them with insults and threats. You know, you're going to get yours. You got no idea who you're messing with. Watch this. Instead of doing that, what does he do? He submitted to them. He submitted to them, and he kept trusting in God the Father, the one who judges justly, and thus who can be counted on to right all wrongs. And you see, I mean, Jesus, he could have smoked everybody. Right? He could have smoked everybody. They're beating him and spitting on him and crucifying him and treating him all that. And what's he do? He just submits. He just submits, knowing he keeps trusting in the Father who judges justly. And he knows it's in his hands. It's in his hands. Now, if we could grasp this, I think it would go a long way toward peace in our lives. I'm not saying it's easy. I'd be the last person to say it's easy. But I think it would go a long way toward peace in our lives. And you look at it and you say, you know, it's a high calling. See, being a Christian is about tremendous transformation of the self. And here's a perfect example of it, you see. Now, having cited the Lord as an example of submission to unjust treatment, Peter then, he alludes to other verses in Isaiah 53. He speaks of the Lord's crucifixion that brought us healing from sin so that we might live for righteousness. Okay, he's in Isaiah 53, draws on, alludes to those texts, speaking about his crucifixion that brings us healing from sin. And this radical change of orientation where, how had they been living? They'd been living one way. He says, in order that having died to sins, we might live for righteousness. By his wound, you were healed. Through his death, through his suffering, through his sacrifice, where he submitted, what happened? You're blessed. You're blessed. And then in verse 25, he summarizes this radical change in orientation that they have experienced. He says, for you were going astray like sheep, weren't we? I don't know about your life. What were you doing? You were just plugged into the culture. You were doing whatever. You were just lost, wandering, pointless. Maybe you were thinking about killing yourself because you say, what in the world? There's no purpose to life. I know people like that. Well, that's a wandering like sheep. Well, what happened? But now in their conversion, you see, the gospel came to them. What happened? They said, now, he says, for you were going like sheep, but you have now turned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. You've come to Jesus Christ. You were wandering. You were lost. And you've turned and you've come to Jesus Christ, the shepherd and overseer of their souls, the one who will bless and protect them and lead them to eternal glory. That is who he is. Okay, the shepherd and overseer of their souls. That is the one. We were living for self. We were out here. Then he says, Christ himself bore our sins in his body in order that having died in sins, we might live for righteousness. By his wound you were healed, for you were going astray like sheep, but now you've turned. That's conversion. You see, that's conversion. You have gone from self, world, all this, and you just said, I'm yours. I'm yours. I live to glorify you. And thank you for the life you've blessed me with. Okay, in chapter 3. Oh, sorry, let me give you this. This is Norman Hillier. And if you remember that this call to submission here is in the larger context of helping to draw pagans into the kingdom of God. And here's what Hillier says in his commentary on 1 and 2 Peter and Jude. He says, masters fall into two main types. Some are good and considerate in their dealings with servants, who therefore do not find it difficult to submit. Right? It's not difficult to submit when somebody's great. Right? That's not hard. It's a breeze. Okay, he says, for servants having to deal day after day with masters who are harsh and mean and who mistreat those who serve them, however, it's another story. Yet in both situations, Peter tells his readers that it is their Christian duty to submit cheerfully. Their constancy in bearing whatever they have to suffer in the course of duty is a powerful sign to those over them that they possess inner resources beyond the natural. This positive attitude may indeed cause annoyance to an uncomprehending pagan master who expects a very different response. That in itself witnesses to the special grace believers are given and could be the means of prompting a desire in the master to share the believer's secret. And you can just picture this, can't you? Can you see how mind-blowing it would be that if somebody mistreats you and is saying everybody else he's ever had dealings with would punch him, throttle him, just sit here or do something. And this person sits here and says, you know, you're my boss, you're my master in this case. And then cheerfully continues to go, this guy's going to be scratching his head. And he's going to wonder, what is it about this person that calls him to live this way? To be the best servant I have, though I treat him worse than any. Why is that? Now, there are no guarantees here that everybody's going to sit here and say, oh, I see you're a Christian. Where are the waters? May I be baptized? But you see, we are called to serve Christ. He lived a certain way. He says, listen, this is how you are to be. And you can see how that would affect people. Where they would sit here and say, look, I don't know who Christ is. But ever since my servant, my employee got tied up with him, he's been better than anybody else. I wish I could have every one of them like this one. Well, do you see what does that preaches, baby? That preaches in a world and in a society. Okay, chapter 3. The bell's going to ring here in just a second. This is submission of wives to husbands, and I do this just like I do the thing we talk about slaves. In our society and in our culture, my opinion is that when you talk about this, you need to say some things. Okay, you need to say some things at the beginning. And I want to do that, and I just don't have time to do it now. So when we next gather, Lord willing, I will start with this, and I will go through and like I say, there are just some things to understand, a framework in which to see things so that, you know, people aren't, you know, jumping off the roof here and pulling their hair out. Wives are called to submit to the leadership of their husbands. Okay, our society is trying desperately to change that. But the word is clear. OK, but there's a larger context for that. And I'll talk about that when we next get together. Thanks for coming.